5 pieces of equipment, only 5. That's all you need to have a successful portable activation. Be it POTA or SOTA, this will get you on the air. Hi, I'm Michael, KB9VBR, your host for Ham Radio Q&A. I'm on a mission to inspire and educate the amateur radio community, and today we're going to talk about the 5 things that you need for getting out into the field for a portable ham radio operation. So stop buying gear. You already have many of, if not all, of these 5 pieces in your arsenal. But let's start out with the transceiver. Ham radio transceivers come in all shapes and sizes, and some models are specifically designed for portable operation. But you don't need a fancy, expensive rig to get on the air. What you're using in a shack will work just fine, and you can use it in the field. For years and years, my ICOM IC718 served double duty as both my field and my shack radio. And once I felt that I wanted to do more operating outdoors, I added a more portable specific rig to the mix in the form of a Yaesu FT891. Did I need to do that? No, but it made my life easier and portable operation more convenient. So get started with what you have. And if you enjoy it, well then consider upgrading to something more portable specific. The keystone of your portable system is the antenna. Antennas come in all shapes and sizes, and there is no right or wrong antenna to use. Every antenna has their trade-offs, and efficiency needs to be weighed against portability and ease of setup. I carry 3 simple antennas with me: a homebrew 20 and 40 meter dipole antenna, a vertical antenna in the form of a Wolf River coil, and an end-fed half-wave antenna. I've got other options, but these 3 give me the versatility to be able to deploy in a wide variety of settings. This setup is also relatively inexpensive. You can build the dipole antenna for only a few dollars. I have a video that tells you how to do that down below in the description. And the other 2 antennas are reasonably affordable. If I wanted to start even simpler, I'd leave out the end-fed half-wave and just focus on the dipole and the vertical. But you'll want to have an antenna in your kit that you can deploy without relying on trees as a means of support, as a tree may not be available or allowed to be used at your location. Power is necessary, and in the field, battery power is king. But how much power do you need? Well, in most cases, a 12 amp hour lithium iron phosphate battery will give you a couple hours of operating time. And if you turn your transmit power down to 50 or 25 watts, you can extend its life even longer. Lithium iron phosphate batteries have become quite inexpensive, and their lightweight and long life make up for the cost difference as compared to a 12 volt AGM or a marine battery. I like to use this 12 amp hour battery myself. I have a link to it in the description, and I also have a little bit larger 20 amp hour battery that I will use for longer activations. But compared to AGM batteries that I used to use, these lithium iron phosphate batteries are lighter, they last longer, and they charge faster. You'll need coaxial cable to connect everything up. In the field, I use RG8X as it is a lightweight and inexpensive, and it also has good loss characteristics for the HF band. So I am really not losing any efficiency using this lightweight cable. I'll carry 2 50-foot lengths and 2 25-foot pieces, but starting out, you know, 1 50-foot and 1 25-foot piece will get you going. Having an extra piece of cable with you is a good in case of a connector breaks or the cable gets damaged. Plus, I've been in situations where 50 feet wasn't enough to deploy the antenna where I wanted to. So adding that extra 25 feet let me put the antenna and the radios exactly where I wanted them to be. Some of my favorite cables are down in the video description below. Now let's talk logging. You need to keep track of your contacts, so logging them is important and as easy as using a piece of paper. I like to use a steno book for paper logging. You know, sheets are all in order and the 6x9-inch size seems to be just perfect. But if you like pre-printed forms, Rusty N0KTZ makes a nice one that's available on his website. I got a link below. But what about if you want to bring that computer into the field? Well, computer logging makes the after-action logging process so much easier, as you don't have to re-enter the contacts into a logging program to build the ADF file for submission. HamRS is a popular choice for a lightweight, Parks on the Air specific logging app, and is available on a wide variety of platforms. N3FJP also makes a popular logging program for contests and special events, and has a general logging app for Windows machines that works well for Parks on the Air. Whatever you choose, you know, pick something you're comfortable with, as contacts are going to come in hot and heavy once you get on the air. And that's it. Those are the five things that you need for a successful portable operation. Nothing more is really necessary, and you can get on the air and have a great time with the bare minimum of equipment. And I bet that you already have many of these pieces already. But if you're looking for a couple of things to make your life easier, here are two optional pieces of gear. First is the antenna analyzer. It is invaluable in the field to check your antenna system and attune and adjust your vertical antenna. I use the Rig Expert AA stick analyzer for that purpose, but an inexpensive Nano VNA will also work too, just not as elegantly as the stick. Actually, you can get by without the analyzer by using the SWR meter in your transceiver and making a few test transmissions at low power. Next up is the antenna tuner. Tuners help match non-resonant antennas to your transceiver and extend the bandwidth of a resonant antenna. But a tuner isn't necessary. If you're using one of these three basic antennas, such as a dipole, NFED, or adjustable vertical antenna, some rigs even have a tuner built in, and their 3-to-1 matching capabilities may be sufficient for your needs. But really, you know, when you're just getting started, pick an antenna that doesn't require a tuner, and you can avoid that piece of optional equipment. These simple building blocks are all you need, so what are you waiting for? Don't let others tell you that you need this or that or the other thing for successful Parks on the Air activation. You probably have most of these parts already, and you're cell set to get on the air. So leave me a comment and tell me your experience. Once you've assembled these five things and you want to go to the next level, I do have a video on 10 simple hacks to make your Parks on the Air activation more enjoyable. You can click over here to keep watching. But that's it for this time. I'm Michael, KB9GBR. Have a great day in 73.